So first of all, welcome everyone. So indeed, today I will be talking about creating a hybrid and multi-cloud strategy using Azure API Management. So a little bit about myself, quick introduction. So I'm Elt Groteboer, and I come from Netherlands, where I work indeed at Motion 10. So we're a company focused on everything Microsoft, basically. So we focus on Azure, Microsoft 365, integration, BI, basically everything that has to do with Azure and some on-prem stuff as well. So myself, I'm cloud solution architect. I focus basically only on Azure these days. I'm also Microsoft MVP, so I like to blog, write articles, write books, do speaking. Basically, I like to work with the community. And if you have any questions or want to reach out to me, I'm always available on Twitter. So you can always reach me here if you have any questions or something else. And today we will be talking about Azure API Management. And so Azure API Management basically allows us to solve some challenges around our API strategy. So when we have APIs, normally we have connected experiences. So we have things that are connecting to our APIs, to our backend services. This might be websites, other APIs, devices, mobile apps, basically anything that wants to connect to us. And then in the backend, we have our services and data that we want to expose. And in the middle, we have those APIs that are connecting our front end to our backend services. This is where API Management basically lives in this space here in the middle. So we can basically define three different pillars. Our app developers, so the people that are creating the APIs, that are creating the connect experience, that are using our APIs. We have our API Management itself in the middle. And have the API publishers that are creating those backend services and exposing them to the connected experiences. And each of these have different needs, different challenges that API Management helps to solve. So the API publishers, for example, want to abstract those services. So we have these backend services, but we don't want our connected experience to know about these backend services. They shouldn't know, is this running on a logic app, on a function, on an AKS cluster? So all that stuff with all the different type of authentication, different types of connections, all that those things, we want to abstract that away. So API Management allows us to be there in the middle and abstract away the backend from the front end. So our connect experience just connect to API Management. They have a single endpoint, maybe some different operations or some different APIs on top of that. They have a single way of authentication, a single way of communication. So everything is JSON, everything is REST normally. And they don't care about the backend systems anymore. API Management also allows us to secure and protect our APIs. And this is very important because those services and the data that we are exposing can be very, we don't want anyone to just connect to this. This might be our HR data, our financial data, our order system. We don't want just anyone to connect to those. We want to make sure that only those experience connect that actually are allowed to. So maybe our clients, maybe our partners, maybe it's something that we expose to the internet and you have to have a subscription for it, things like that. So API Management allows us to have different types of authentication, different types of authentication in the front end and in the back end, and that way make sure that we can securely expose our APIs. API Management also allows us to build smarter services. So the backend service might be more legacy. There might be things here that we don't really want to touch anymore, but we still want to make them smarter. API Management allows us to policies. For example, there's a policy to add caching. So without having to touch our backend service, within API Management, we can add the cache on top of that. And then we can say, okay, if the same request comes in within 5 minutes, we just get it from the cache instead of going to our backend service. So there's a couple of different policies that we have. I think there's about 50 or so out of the box, maybe a bit more. And we can also create our own policies that will help with this. API Management also allows us to manage our lifecycle. We can create versions and revisions, which basically allows us to create new APIs that will be lived side by side with versions. And revisions allow us to add some non-breaking changes on the APIs and expose those in the lifecycle management. We can monitor and measure the use of our APIs, so we can see who's using them, how often are they being used, who's calling them from where. So that's the publishers. Now for the app developers, so the people that are consumer APIs, they also have some challenges. So they want to know which APIs are out there, which APIs are being exposed. API management helps here through the API management portal. So you get a developer portal, and here they get an overview of all the APIs that are available to them. They can then also get a subscription on those APIs. So they will get a subscription key, and this subscription key they can then use to call those APIs, which will then grant them access and give us insights into who's using them. They can try those APIs out right from this developer portal. So in the developer portal, you have a try it out button. We, as the API publishers, can add some data on there, so some sample data. And then the app developers can use this portal to see, okay, how's this working? What happens if I change this? And normally you would connect this maybe to a pre-production environment. So you have real life data there without actually hitting your production, of course. And also provide some code samples. So you can get different samples of, okay, what? How do I implement this? So our developers can just copy this code, paste it into their own application, and start with this. So we have the developer portal for our developers. We have the gateway itself, which is basically the abstraction between our front-end and back-end services. And we have the Azure portal, where we publish those APIs and monitor and manage them. And normally, we will have this running in API Manager running in Azure. And then whenever someone connects to it, they will connect to our API management, and that will connect to our backend service. Also, if you are running between Azure itself, our service will connect to the API management and connect to our backend other backend service. So far, everything is fine and dandy. But what if you have a hybrid or multi-cloud strategy? We might have some service running in Google Cloud, or maybe in AWS. Or we might also have some on-premise services. And we maybe not want to have everything running to Azure. Because now if we want to connect to our Google Cloud, for example, we would connect to Azure API Management and then connect to Google Cloud. Of course, it adds latency, things like that. Same with if we go to AWS, we would go to API Management, then go to AWS, which is, again, latency being added. And it gets even stranger when we want to connect in AWS to AWS, because now from AWS, we are connecting to Azure and then connecting back to AWS, which seems kind of strange, but still we want to have that API management in place because we want to have that abstraction. We want to have those insights. And the worst one is even when we are talking about on-premise, because now from on-premise, we need to go out to Azure back on-premise again. So when we want to call one on-premise application to another on-premise application, we have to go to the cloud. We have to open up firewalls. We might have data that should not be going to the cloud, because that might be one of the reasons why it's still on-premise, is because it's not allowed to go over the cloud. And now, just because we want to use API management, we have to go out to the cloud and go back into our on-premise environment again. So once again, not the best experience there. So instead, we would use a hybrid API management strategy. So what this means is that we would actually have API management running with our services. So this might be in Google Cloud, on-premises, AWS, wherever you want. And there's different scenarios that we would use for this. So I will be talking about different clients that we are working with that already are doing this now, because the functionality I'm talking about, the on-premise data gateway, on-premise self-host gateway, sorry. The self-host gateway from API Manager has been announced at Build, or actually it was G8 at Build. And so we have been implementing this with different clients now. And one of the clients is TBI. They're a construction company. And so they still have like a large on-premises landscape. They still have a lot of applications that are running on-premises and that won't be moving to the cloud on short term at least. And all these systems on-premises are communicating with each other. There's a couple of Azure services there as well, but there's also still a lot of the things that are just communicating on-premises to on-premises. And aside from using API management, they don't really have need to go out to the internet for these services. So here it would be very nice if they could just say, okay, we're going to run API management on-premises, and whatever is running on-premises just can connect to that on-premise API management and just stay everything on-premise. Another scenario we see is when you are working disconnected. So for example, Stolt Tankers is one of our clients, and they actually are running services on those ships. So on those ships, they have their own mini data centers. They have a few different APIs that are running there, but they still want to have that consistent management and governance. So they still want the API management in there because they want to make sure that they actually have the governance on top of that, that they can see what's happening there. But of course, on the ships, you have intermittent connection. They're running on satellite connections. Satellite connections are quite expensive for high reliability. So for these kind of things, they really don't want that. It's mostly IoT data. So it's mostly data about, okay, how are they things running, things like that. So it has to run, but they don't really want to have everything going over the internet all the time. So here it would be very nice if they could just run API management on the ship with the rest of the services. And the final scenario is multi-cloud. So this client is called De Rij. They are a big conference center in the Netherlands, and they do a lot of big events. And so what they have systems that are basically giving you access to the conference. So the gates that you have to go through, you scan your ticket, the gate opens. So that scanning of the date of the ticket and then checking if you are allowed to go in, if you are not trying to get in twice, things like that. That's a service that's running there. And you can imagine that that kind of service cannot be down, because if there's like 10,000 people trying to get in and your system is down, then you have a big problem. So they want to deploy this to multiple clouds. So they want to make sure that this service is running in multiple locations. So they are running in Azure, AWS, and on-premise. And they also thinking about, okay, so we now are already having, we already have multiple clouds. So they also try to use different strengths of those clouds. So some things might be better in Azure, other things might be better in AWS, but they still want to have that governance, to have that maintenance through API management. So this is where the self-host gateway comes in. So like I said, the self-host gateway has gone GA during build and basically allows you to run API management anywhere. So, like I said, it allows you to run anywhere. So wherever you can run containers, you can run API management now. It allows you to have lower latency. So like I said, if you are running in AWS, you don't have to go out to Azure first, then go back to AWS again. You can just stay in AWS and not have the latency there. And you can also work disconnected. So API management self-host gateway allows you to run disconnected. It can work without internet connection. And so basically allows you to run this completely disconnected, unless of course you want to push some updates, but once it's running, it can run completely disconnected. So now we would have API management, not just in Azure, but also in Google Cloud, in AWS, and on-premises. So of course, if you are connected to Azure, we are still doing everything to Azure API management. But now if you're connected to a Google Cloud service, we are instead just connecting to our Google Cloud API management in Google Cloud. And from there, we connect to our backend service there. Same when we are running to Azure. So we're going to the AWS instance here, and we are going to do it like this. And of course, we now also can say, if we are running in AWS, we can just call this API management here and go to our backend service like this. And for our on-premise system, it now means we don't have to go out to Azure anymore. We don't have to go to the cloud. We can just completely stay on-premises. So there's a few pros and cons for Azure API management versus self-host gateway. First of all, both the Azure API management and the self-host gateway of API management have the same single pane of management and monitoring. So within Azure, you still have all your insights, of whether you're running in Azure or on-premises or in another cloud. So infrastructure, of course, with Azure API management, Microsoft manages everything for the infrastructure, whereas for the self-host gateway, you have to do this yourself. Uptime with Azure API management, of course, is Microsoft's responsibility. If you're running self-host gateway, you have to make sure that you have your uptime, that everything is up and running. Now, latency might be elevated if you're using Azure API management, because you are first going to Azure and then to your backend system. So if your backend system is not running in Azure, you cannot go against physics. So you actually have to have some extra latency on that. Self-host gateway allows you to minimize the latency because you can now run your API management next to your service. Security and compliance might be challenging with Azure because you are running in the cloud. So that might have some challenges. On the other hand, self-host gateway means you're running your own infrastructure, so that also might have some challenges. So think about these kind of things as well. And egress charges. So when you're running in Azure and you're doing egress, you are paying for this. The self-host gateway, you only pay for that instance. And so the self-host gateway is only available in the premium tier. So you need at least one premium tier instance. And then you pay half of a premium tier instance, you pay also for your self-host gateway. So it's not the cheapest option. But then again, if you need this kind of functionality, it's still quite a bit cheaper than a lot of the competition. And if you are running this kind of scenario, you are probably running in enterprise scenarios. So that kind of money is still basically nothing to an enterprise. So what features do we get? First of all, we have centralized management. Like I said, everything is managed from Azure. So you still go to the Azure portal. You still create your APIs as you would normally do with an Azure API management. And then you push it out to your local instances. So within Azure, you can now say, OK, these APIs need to go to these self-host gateways. And you can also get an overview of all those instances. So you don't just get insights into your API management in Azure, but you also get insights from all those local instances, wherever they're running. They just push the telemetry back to Azure. And within the Azure portal, you have that nice central view of all those instances. No matter if you're just running one instance or 10 instances, you have a nice overview. So it's running on containers. So it's Docker containers. So wherever you can run a Docker container, you can now run API management. And of course, Docker runs everywhere these days. I think I even have a bread toaster over here that runs Docker these days. So Docker can run everywhere. So you can now run API management everywhere. It's an image that's available from Microsoft Container Registry, meaning that Microsoft is maintaining this image. Microsoft making sure that the latest updates are always in there. Microsoft always makes sure that it's safe, and you just have to pull this container and run it. And so most of the features of API management are in there. Not everything is available, at least not out of the box. So you don't get out of the box caching. So you can still bring your own cache. So for example, if you bring Redis, you can still use caching, but you don't get an out-of-the-box caching in there. You don't get a develop portal, which I think is logical because developers can just go to your Azure API Management portal. So you don't need a local portal as well. And there's also TLS and certificates are not out-of-the-box. Once again, you can, of course, bring your own certificates and push TLS up in that way, and same for client certificates. So you can have all the functionality. It just takes a bit more time to set it up. And like I said, you can work completely disconnected. And this is also very nice, because once you have your API management self-host gateway up and running, whenever the internet connection goes down, they do a fail static, which basically means whatever is running at that point will keep running. And they will use in-memory configuration for this. So basically, once you start up your API management self-host gateway, everything is loaded into memory. And at that point, it just keeps running with that fail static. So if you are now running disconnected, you will not, of course, get any updates, but it will keep running. One thing to note here is if you don't do any additional configuration, if you restart your servers or your servers go down, the in-memory copy is gone and it will not get up again. However, you can use a local backup. And if you configure this, then if you don't have a connection, if you restart your servers or goes down for whatever reason, if you bring it back up, it will use that local copy and it will use that to do your to run that self-host gateway. So with that, enough theory, let's go to demos, because we all love demos. So let's have a look how this actually looks in practice. So the scenario I'm going to talk about is the scenario above the guy. So I just talked about this. So what we have here, we have the service. So in this case, it's that gate, that scanning gate, where we push up our ticket, and it will scan the ticket and check, OK, are you allowed to go in? So the guy has a big Azure landscape. So they have a lot of different services, mostly PaaS services. So logic apps, functions, event grid, storage, Cosmos DB, all those nice stuff. And in this case, they, of course, also have API management. And then they have a function. And this function here, that basically does a lookup into a database, in this case, a SQL database on Azure. And they just do a lookup and see, OK, is this ticket, has it already been scanned? Do we know this ticket? Which person is this? Things like that. So there's a couple of checks in there, like that say, okay, can you come in? And of course, this goes lightning fast. Like you all have been, like whether in an airport or in a venue, like you scan your ticket, they do the check, they say, okay, you can come in. And this for the ride, this is running on Azure in Functions. Now, like I said, this is highly critical because if those scanners do not work, either they have to open up the venue for everyone because they cannot check the ticket anymore, or they have to, cannot let anyone in, which is especially no-go. So this has to be up and running to make sure that they can make sure that who's coming in actually is allowed to come in. So what we did is we have mentioned running in the self-host gateway in that container, and we are running this on a VM. So they have an on-premise, they have like their own little data center there. Well, little, it's actually quite big for just a venue, but they still have their own DC running, and there we are now running in Docker. We are running this API management self-host gateway. We are also running the same function also on the container because functions can also run in containers. And then we have just a normal SQL installation, like normal SQL. We all know this, like an on-premise installation, where we have the same data as we have in Azure SQL. We also have on-premises. So this scenario that we are going to look at. So first, let's have a look at the Azure site. So in Azure, we have an Azure database. Like I said, it's just normal SQL to Azure database, where we have our data. We have a function that we are running. And we have Azure API Management. So let's have a look. First of all, let's have a look at the database. So nothing too special here, it's just a database, but just to show you, like I said, it's an Azure SQL database, and we have a table here called registrations. And if I run here, I will see that I have one record in there. It's mine, it's myself. I registered for Microsoft Ignite Tour. And of course, in the actual database, there's lots more fields here around, okay, well, what type of ticket is this? Has it already been scanned, things like that. But now what I just want to show you is I can get a registration. If I call registration one, I will see, okay, there's a registration here. I call this database from my function. So switch, there we go. Just get rid of this. And this function, as you can see, is like a very simple function, very lightweight, as a function should be. What I do is I do a selection on my registrations table. I get, I pass in an ID for my call. I check, okay, do we have this ID in my table? If yes, then I find my registration and the gate will open. If not, then I will get back a message saying, hey, it was not found and the gate will stay closed. One thing I want to show you here is I have this these two environment variables. One is my environment, one is my SQL connection string. And actually, I'm running this in Azure, of course. So let's go over here. I have my function running here. There we go. So I have my function running here. It's just a function. It gets an HTTP call and then doesn't run my function that I just showed you. Port is a little bit slow, so let's actually go over here. Because what I want to show you in this configuration is that I actually have like configuration here. My environment is Azure. And of course, I'm just pointing to my Azure database. So let's see over here. I have my environment. This one I want to show you. So my environment is just Azure. And of course, I have my SQL connection string here pointing to this database over here. And finally, I have API management and my API management over here. This is where my function has been, how I expose my function to the outside world. So that gate basically goes to API management, does the call to the function from there, and then gets back that information. So in this policy, as you will see, I have this policy. So then this is important because my policy is being, my API is being pushed both to my on-premises gateway and my Azure, of course. So in this write demo, I have this retrieve registration operation, and this policy basically says, okay, whenever you come in, first check the host name. If my host name is my VM, then I'm going to do this backend to my Docker container. So in this case, I would be calling my Docker container. If it is not my VM, then I'm going to call this, and here I'd send my backend to my function running in Azure. Now, if I'm running in Azure, I need to get my my key for my function, my function key. So I do call to out to key vault. Sorry. So I do call to key vault. I get my function key. I set my function key header here, and then I'm going to set my URI. And I have some limitations here as well, like I don't really want to do 60 calls per minute, things like that. So now whenever I call this, I just call this out and I will just get back my result here. So let's have a look. So I have my API management endpoint over here. So as you can see, it's just my API management running in Azure. And here I'm calling out to this write demo endpoint with my registration ID 1. So if I call out to this, it will call out to my API management. It will call that will call out to my function in the backend, and it will then get back my results. And indeed, I found the registration for LDAT in environment Azure. So this is just running in Azure, just like we did for years. Very nice. Just to show this actually is running like my function. If I have another ID, you will see I don't get the response back. So this is all working. Go back over here. So this is my Azure solution. Now on premises, I have a similar solution. So I have a SQL Server database. I have the same function running there, and I have my self-host gateway running API management. So if I go to my VM, like I said, I have my SQL database over here. So it's the same data. As you can see, it's the same data over here. I'm running a function. So if I go over, not this one, actually over here. So the same function. However, I'm now running my function in Docker. So in my Docker container, I have an environment file over here. And in my environment, I have my virtual machine. And of course, I connect to my on-premise database. So this running in Docker, Docker.ps. So I have two containers running. One is my, let me get this open. One is my gateway. One is my function. So this is just running there. And I can now just call this on-premise gateway over here. So I have my self-host gateway. As you can see, it's running on my virtual machine URL. So it's running here in this VM endpoint. And if I call this, I will see that I get, indeed, I get a my virtual machine. So this is now running on premises, and I just call this on-premise endpoint. I can even say, okay, I am on this local machine. So I can even say, I just call my local host. So my local host, you can see just local host. So I'm not going over the internet. I'm just calling my local host, and indeed I get a response back, my virtual machine. So this is now running on-premise, both on-premises and in Azure. So this means that we can now just run, normally we'll run in Azure. Here we go. So we are running in Azure, and but at some point we might go down. So we have to make sure that we can actually switch over. So first we are going to think about, okay, how am I going to make my data there? So I have data in Azure, and I want to make sure I have the same data on premises. So for this, we use SQL Sync. And SQL Sync allows you to synchronize your data between an Azure database and another database. I'll also show you this check-in function. So what we are going to do is once we scan this ticket, we are going to check in this person. And we also have to think about, okay, if that connection goes out, how are we going to switch over? So like I said, I'm running a couple of different things here. So first of all, let's have a look at that data sync. So if we go over here to my database over here, you will see in this SQL database, you have this option to sync to other databases. And here you can define a sync group. You have a defined sync group and a sync agent. And the sync group basically says, okay, I've got different databases that I want to sync. So my SQL database in Azure, and I have another database on premises. So here we go. So I have my Azure database over here, and I have my on-premises database over here, which is just a database that I showed you running on premises. As you can see, this just syncs every couple of minutes. It will just do a sync and just make sure that all the data that's in Azure also is on premises and the other way around as well. So this is first how I sync my data. So this makes sure ensures that my data on premises is the same as it is in Azure. Then I have this function running here, my check-in function. And in this check-in function, what I do here is so whenever someone comes in, it will just call to my local host write demo. So this is just one function that's calling the on-premise data gateway of API management, that's then calling that other function that's also running there. So if I call this function, it will just go out to my API management, call the other function, get back the response from that other function, and respond back to my client. So let's have a look at that. So I have my function check in here. As you can see, I'm calling my local host. The function is calling back to another local host. And if I do a send this request, I will just see, okay, I indeed got a response registration found for etd aan het grote boer in environment my virtual machine. And my visitor one has now been checked in. So we now have this function that's calling another function. So now let's think about, okay, and this is important. So I have this running now in Azure and on premises. What happens if my Azure goes down? I need an endpoint that can see, okay, my endpoint is down. So if Azure goes down, and let's actually simulate this Azure going down, for some reason, it's probably DNS. It's always DNS. So DNS has a problem. If I go to my API management over here, I can now say, I'm going to set a mock response 503. Actually, what I would first want to show you before I do the save this, I first want to show you I have this I have my API management behind front door. So for those that don't know front door allows you to do many different things. But one of the things that it allows you to do is do routing to over different endpoints. You can have different kinds of routes. So in this case, I have a route set up where I have priority one for Azure, priority two for my on premises. This basically means that if my Azure goes down, it will see, hey, my Azure is down. I'm now going to route it to my secondary endpoint, which is my on-premise endpoint. So I've got it run here. Actually, I think I need this one. What I want to show you is that I have different priorities for my different backends. Yeah, here it is. So, okay, let's just wait. So I have a backend, my Azure API management has priority one, and my VM has priority three. I could also do some load balancing and stuff like that, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to say if my first endpoint is down, I'm going to call my second endpoint. And so if I call this endpoint of my front door, so I'm now calling front door. At this point, API management in Azure is still up and running. So if I call this, I should get it back from Azure, which indeed we do. Now, if Azure goes down because of DNS, so let's go over here. I'm now going to say, okay, instead of calling my backend, I'm going to return a 503. So let's save this. Takes a minute to a couple of seconds to save. So it's now saving my policy. And from now on, this API will just return 503 instead of my actual function call. Let's hope it will start saving. In the meantime, let me just go over. Let me just open another one. So, of course, because I'm streaming now, it takes a bit of my bandwidth probably. Yeah, there we go. So it's now it has been saved. So I'm now returning 503. And also have to have a health probe here. So this is actually what my front door is using to check how healthy is my environment. Oh, I need all operations. And here I'm just going to say, okay, for my VM, 503, for my Azure, sorry, not for my VM, for my Azure, the health probe will also here say, okay, you get a 503 back. So now my front door will start checking my health probe every, I think every minute or so. So it takes like one or two minutes to update this, but it will see, hey, my health probe in Azure is saying it's down. So I should now switch over to my other endpoint, which is of course in my VM. So let's see if I now call my front door. I'm getting a 503 for now. So this, like I said, it takes like, I think 1 or 2 minutes for this to switch over. So let's come back to this in like just a moment. In the meantime, I quickly want to go back here because I have one more slide I want to go through. So like I said, you configure this from your Azure API management. You can use environment specific variables. So make sure that you do this, because if you're connected on-premise to an on-premise database and Azure SQL database, use those different environment variables. And also you get a nice single pane of glass. So let's have a quick look at this. Well, we are waiting for our front door to switch over. So here in my API management, I've got this gateways option over here. And so here I have one gateway, my demo gateway, which is running on premises. And here I can first with APIs, I can see, okay, I've got these two APIs running here. So I've got my health probe and my write demo. I don't have my Echo API running over here. So if I'm trying to call my Echo API on premises, I will not get a response. So I will get a response. So you can actually say for different self-host gateways, you can have different APIs running on different locations. And if I go to overview, I can actually see all the calls that are going to my on-premise API. I can see if I get any bad requests. So I can see I made some backend requests here. I can see if I get any errors. So as you can see, I now have a single pane of glass where I can see everything is running and I can just see, okay, how are things doing? So let's see if front door has already updated. Yes, it has. So now you see, okay, I'm now calling the same front door instance. So I'm not changing any URLs, but I now get back a response from my virtual machine instead of from Azure. So this is of course very nice, because this just allows us to say, okay, whenever Azure goes down, just route it to my on-premise machine. Of course, if entire of Azure goes down, so let's say if you want to work disconnected, you cannot use front door, because if your internet goes out, you cannot use front door. So in that case, I might say, okay, I'm going to build it into my own application where I will just do my own health checks to see if I can actually reach my Azure. If not, I would call to my on-premise environment then. So there's a couple of different options, but I really like front door for this kind of things. Front door is very highly available. So Microsoft actually runs most of their own environments on top of front door. So actually like Office runs on front door. So it's quite highly available, because if this goes down, then half of Microsoft Azure goes down and half of Office goes down. So this one of the services I know will basically always be available. So we now have seen how we can use Azure API management or self-host gateway to run our own API management on premises and AWS, wherever we want. We have this nice insights, everything. We can call it from anywhere. So a few takeaways. This self-host gateway allows us to expose our service running anywhere, no matter if this is in Azure, in AWS, in Google Cloud, on premises. As long as you can run a container, you can run a self-host gateway, and you can run your API management right next to your services. This is very nice, because it means low latency. It means you don't have to go out to Azure to call anywhere else. It means for your on-premise environment that you don't have to open up any firewalls anymore or anything like that. But that's very nice. You get this nice single pane of configuration management. Just your Azure API management is where you go. You make your APIs, you edit your policies there. Everything is just pushed from there. You have all those insights. So you have all those insights in how things are running. Do you get any errors or anything like that? And think about running disconnected. So think about, okay, how am I going to run disconnected? Think about that if you need that local copy of your connection. Do you think that your entire internet can go out? If so, make sure you make the local copy. It's a couple minutes to set up, and it makes sure that you can just go back up and running if your service goes down and you don't have an internet connection. So with that, I would like to say thank you. If you have any questions, push them into the chat or contact me on Twitter or on email. If you want to connect, like I said, you can always contact me on Twitter. If you want to connect on LinkedIn, my contact info is there as well. So thank you. And